Hello, it's Thiago Soto from QUIC. Thanks for joining this webinar. Today we have our CTO, Anton Roman, who is going to explain well, the new internet protocols. We are going to talk about HTTP2, SPDY, and QUIC. At the end of this webinar, we will have some time to try to answer some of your questions. So please, I think that all of you have access to the chat, the question tool where you can make your questions, and we will try to reserve 5 to 10 minutes at the end of the webinar to try to answer these questions. And remember that the slides of the webinar will be available, so do not hesitate to request them, and we will try to send you these slides. So, Anton, I think that's your time, and we'll try to book some minutes at the end to try to answer the questions of the audience.
Okay. Hello, Yago. Thanks for the introduction. Okay, as Yago said, I'm Anton Roman, I'm the CTO at QUOBIS. Okay, first of all, let's review quickly the objectives of this webinar, the goals of the webinar. Okay, the first goal is to understand why the current version of HTTP, the version which is being used currently in almost all the web servers, HTTP 1.1, cannot meet the requirements of the new web applications, okay? And then we'll learn the rationale behind the new internet protocols, why new internet protocols are necessary. We'll also get into details about HTTP2. We'll learn the main features and the main differences of HTTP2 respect to the HTTP 1.1, and last but not least, we'll comment some issues regarding HTTP2 and real time. Okay. Well, today, information technology is getting browser centric. Okay, the first application you open when you start your laptop every morning is the web browser, and very likely it's also the last one you close when you suspend your laptop in the afternoon. Okay, so you spend a lot of time in the browser, and that's not a casualty. It's the information technology world is moving in that direction. All the important players have very advanced web application. And for example, Google is investing a lot of money in the development of Google Chrome because it's is a critical point for them. Okay, and HTTP is the protocol which is used by the browsers. Okay, so it makes sense that companies like Google and other information technology actors are investing a lot of money in improving the user experience by modifying the browsers and the protocol which are used by them. Well, I don't know if you know already know that, but latency has more impact in the user experience than bandwidth. Okay, several years ago the bandwidth was very limited, and the user experience wasn't very good at all compared to the to today's standard. But today, latency is the stopper to get a better user experience. Well, in the latency, we have some physical limits. The light of speed is constant, and we cannot improve it. So, and something similar happens in wireless links. When you are connected to a web page through a wireless connection, 3G or 4G, you are going to have a latency, which is a fixed value, very difficult to improve. But at application and transport level, there are many things which can be done to improve that. Okay, so yes, as a first takeaway, consider that HTTP2 and QUIC and the new internet protocols are designed to improve that user experience in any kind of connection, especially mobile connections. Okay. Well, now we are going to explain a little bit the main points about HTTP 1.1 and what aspects are going to be improved in HTTP 2. Okay, well, this is a brief history of HTTP. The concept of hypertest has more than 50 years. In 26 years ago, HTTP and HTML were born. The first version of HTTP was released 20 years ago. 1.1 was released 18 years ago, and in 2014, five new RFCs were released to define the final version of HTTP 1.1. Okay, those RFCs gather all the new elements which were introduced in the protocol, and so we can consider them as the final definition of HTTP 1.1. Well, this is the protocol stack. Okay, as you can see, the lowest part of the stack are very old. IP and TCP are really old protocols, and well, in TCP there were several improvements trying to optimize the throughput, but you can see that is something pretty old. Okay, right now we are using this model. What are we moving to? Okay, we are moving to a new internet when we'll use HTTP2 as an application protocol. We'll see what are the differences and what are the similarities with the current version of HTTP. And behind HTTP 2, we'll have QUIC and UDP. Okay, this is something. I think this is the final picture. But HTTP 2 also can be used over SSL and TCP. Okay, so this is the direction internet is moving. Well, you might think, okay, well, IPv6, which is the next version of IP protocol, which currently we are using IPv4 mainly in internet. So the adoption of IPv6 is taking very long. It started something like 15 years ago, and it's been very, very slow. So, but you have to take into account that for to migrate to IPv6, there is a lot of elements which have to be changed in internet. It affects all the internet nodes, okay? But in the case of HTTP2, it only affects the endpoints and some intermediate elements, like, for example, proxies and load balancers. Okay, but that's something much easier to control. For example, on the end user side, we have just a few vendors, Google, Firefox, Microsoft with Internet Explorer, Opera, and once all of those browsers implements HTTP2, the only missing part are the server, the web servers. Okay, so it's not necessary to change so many nodes. Actually, HTTP2 is being used in many massive websites. For example, a lot of Google traffic is being sent over HTTP2, and the same happens with other sites like Twitter, for example. Okay, well, just a few words about HTTP. It's a client-server protocol. The client sends a request, and the server sends back a response. We can, for example, long polling allows to push information from the server to the client, but that's just a workaround. Okay, it's not the HTTP protocol is client server, and it's stateless. Okay, so its request response couple is in theory independent from each other. Okay, we know that there are elements in HTTP to keep sessions, for example, cookies and so on. Okay, but that's something that was added later, and it's something, well, it's not in the core of the protocol. Okay. Well, and a lot of features were added to HTTP 1.1 when the market needed a new feature, when the market had a new requirement. Some features were added to the protocol. Well, some of them are, for example, content compression. Also byte serving and chunk transfer encoding, which allows to send the content from the server to the client in a more efficient way. Also authentication, which is not very strong. And well, several features which were added, many of them for security reasons, and all of them to meet the demand of the new web applications. Well, right now, you might know that on average, each web page gets more than 90 resources. Okay, resources are JS files, HTML files, and any kind of images. Okay, and on average, they get those resources from 15 different hosts. So when you access to the web page of your favorite newspaper, that page is very likely to get a lot of resources, images, text, JavaScript files, and also very likely that page is going to get those resources from a lot of servers. Okay, HTTP was designed to to use one single server to get all the resources. Okay, but well, as a workaround, web browsers are allowed to implement parallel TCP connections. Okay, so your web browser can create up to 6 TCP connections to the web browser to speed up the load of the content. Okay, so when you access your newspaper web page, you are very likely to open up to 6 TCP connections to each web server. Okay, so you can open a lot of TCP connections to get the your news every day. And it's also a known fact that the efficiency of TCP improves with larger files. Okay, the larger the better in terms of efficiency. Okay, to avoid overhead and so on. So several workarounds were developed to take advantage of these facts. Okay, we are going to explain quickly some of them. For example, spriking. This is a very used technique which consists on having a huge image which contains small images which are going to be used in the web page. Okay, so you can gather all the images you are going to use, all the icons you are going to use in your web page into a single file. So you only have to download from a single image from the web server. Okay, and then you use CSS to get everything in place. Okay, another workaround is file concatenations. Currently, we are using those techniques in our WebRTC products. Okay, but they are state of the art tips to improve the user experience, but they are just workarounds. Okay, it's not a native solution of the protocol to improve the user experience. They are solutions which were found with the time to try to think, to make things better. Okay, in this case, file concatenations consist on well, doing more or less the same. To gather all the different files, the JavaScript files and CSS files, in very large single files. Okay, there is another technique called domain sharding. Well, as we said, there is a limit. It's a limit imposed by the browser. Okay, you can, if you access a web server to access a website, you can open up to 6 TCP connections. So what can you do to improve, to reduce the load time? Okay, so we are going to use a lot of web servers. For example, you can have 3 web servers for images. You can have 2 web servers just for JavaScript files, another one for dynamic content. And you open 6 TCP connections against each server. Okay, so to download a single web page, you can establish connections to a lot of web servers. Okay, well, there are other performance problems. Okay, a technique which was defined in HTTP 1.1 to improve the performance was pipelining. Pipelining consists of sending several requests to the server before receiving the answer, so that you can ask for several resources. For example, you can ask in the first request, you can ask for the index file. In this one, you can ask for an image, and you can send the request before receiving the answer. Okay, but there is a problem with TCP connections called head of line blocking. What does it mean? If you make a lot of simultaneous requests, if any of the well, if you have any problem in the connection, you are going to lose all of them. So you are not going to receive any answer from the server. Okay, and that's not efficient. Actually, pipelining is not used in practice currently. Okay, and well, and there are other performance issues. We are not going to get into more detail to speed up a little bit the presentation. Okay. Another key point in today's internet, internet is moving to an all encrypted paradigm. Okay, so actually there are many features, for example, in WebRTC, like the screen sharing and media capturing as well. That's something new. Only works in websites which have been loaded over HTTPS connections. Okay, so I think in just 1 year, it's going to be very difficult to create a web application which can be loaded over HTTP, okay, without any encryption. And that's something which adds latency as well, because you have to, the TLS protocol has an initial handshake phase, and that has to be that's something that has to be done, okay? And it takes some time because you have several round trips, okay? Well, there are some techniques to improve that. For example, you can open from the browser, you can establish a TLS connection against a local proxy, and then that local proxy can, which is an inverse web proxy, asks for the resources to the origin servers over HTTP. Okay, this way, this is the most sensitive part, because you have a lot of round trips to establish the TLS connection, and then you can get the content. This is supposed to be a secure network. Okay, so this is one technique to improve that. That's something which is not likely to be valid anymore with HTTP2, because HTTP2 is designed to have end-to-end encryption. Okay, so that's something which can impact not only the content providers, but also the operators. There are many operators which try to catch the web content on their network, and when everything is encrypted, that catching is not possible anymore. Okay, so that might increase the bandwidth on the operator side. Okay, that can be one of the side effects of HTTP2, which has to be considered by the operators. Okay, well, we now know the problems of HTTP1, the limitation of HTTP 1.1, so we are going to learn what HTTP2 can do to improve that. Okay, well, user want things better and want them now. Okay, as we said, web pages are constantly getting more complex and bigger in size. Okay, so well, the average size of the index page of many sites is around 1 megabyte. Okay, and then get the content from many servers, opening many connections. Okay, and there is another difference in internet today, is that many of the access to websites happens over mobile connections. Okay, when TCP was designed 30 years ago, there were not a mobile connection, and TCP is not the best protocol, okay, for that kind of connections, which have a higher latency. Well, the bandwidth is not so cheap as for fixed connection, and it's more variable. And when you can have a packet loss depending on the situation of the terminal, okay. So with mobile connections, the things are changing a lot. Well, another key point, and that's one of the reasons why Google spend and well, and other companies spend so much money in reducing the latency. Okay, well, it's a fact that we as consumers buy more if the user experience is better. And latency is a key element to improve user experience, okay? Well, you can check the slides later. We are not too going into detail now, but well, there are real facts which support the idea of the conversion rate versus latency. Well, just three points about HTTP2. Okay, we are going to deal with more of them later. But if you have to get 3 takes takeaways of from this presentation? Okay, well, you can heard about SPDY, S-P-D-Y, okay, but I think the pronunciation is SPDY. Also about HTTP2. Well, SPDY is the was the experimental version of HTTP2. Okay, it was developed by Google. SPDY is used in practice from Chrome, and I think also from Firefox. But right now, SPDY is HTTP2. Okay, SPDY was not defined by an RFC. It was defined internally by Google, and then it was partially open to the community, and now it's an RFC. Actually, it's a consolidated RFC, but it was previously it was a RFC draft where any actor in the internet world, from academia, companies, and so on. Could participate, okay? Well, HTTP2 is an application layer web protocol, okay? But it reuses the HTTP 1.1 semantic. So we don't have new methods here, okay? All that you know about HTTP, except the workarounds we mentioned earlier, are still valid. All the headers we are using today are still valid, okay? So, we can say that the new changes take place at a lower part in the stack protocol. Okay, so you still have all the HTTP semantic, but the way in that those HTTP messages are put on the wire, I send in the network is different. Okay, so the main purpose is to change, to reduce the page load time, the perceived latency, but all the functionality is going to keep unchanged. Okay, well, there are some side effects in the way we program web pages that has to be considered, but the transition in this way is not going to be a problem. Okay, so everything you know about HTTP 1.1 is very likely to remain valid when serving your web application over HTTP2. Well, this is HTTP2 in a phrase, okay? Protocol designed for low latency transfer of content over the World Wide Web. Okay, well, this is what I said, okay? Just a few, 7 months ago, SPDY was frozen and now is HTTP2. Okay, so you don't have to use the term SPDY anymore to refer to the protocol. Okay, so and that's the RFC. Okay, 7540. This is the protocol which is going to transport a great part of the information of the internet in the next years. Okay, what are the main differences between HTTP2 and HTTP 1.1? Well, HTTP2 is binary and HTTP 1.1 is textual. So if you get your wireshark or TCP dump, and you check the packets of HTTP 1.1, you can understand everything. Well, you at least can read everything. You can know that this message is a GET, this one is a POST, and you can know the URL they are hitting. But with HTTP2, it's binary, okay? So you can know what is being sent on the wire by using Wireshark, but you cannot do it by a direct visual inspection of the packet. That has a number of advantages that we are going to see later. HTTP2 is fully multiplex, okay? So you establish an HTTP connection, and you can get all the resources using that connection, you don't need to open a lot of TCP connections against different servers, okay? You can open just one connection, and within that connection, the content is going to be transferred in a very efficient way, and you can even set priorities, and if any of the resources you are getting through a HTTP2 connection is lost or has some kind of corruption due to, for example, network problems, it won't affect the rest of the resources you are getting, okay? Well, as I said, you open just one connection with the server. You have header compression in HTTP2. You have to take into account that a lot of internet traffic is just for HTTP headers, which are not very useful in terms of functionality. So in HTTP2, you can do compression of that headers. In HTTP 1.1, you can compress, but just the content of the HTTP messages. Well, another nice feature of HTTP2 is that the web server can push content on the client. What does it mean? It means that when you load the index HTML of a web page, then you have to get a lot of additional files for images, JavaScript files, and CSS, and so on. And well, the server in HTTP2, the server knows what resources you are going to need, what files you are going to need. So when you get the index file, the server can propose other files to download. Okay, so you don't have to send a lot of GET messages to get all that content. Okay, that reduces the latency. And another important feature, well, it's not a feature, we could say that's a constraint or something mandatory, is to use TLS. Okay, HTTP2 is going to be used always over encrypted transport. You can use HTTP2 over TLS, which goes over TCP, but there is another transport protocol, which in fact is a layer over UDP called QUIC, which also have native encryption. Okay, so what does it mean? That in practice, you are the browser is going to get the content that the web server is sent, and no one can investigate that traffic. Okay, in HTTP 1.1, the TLS use is optional. Okay, why HTTP2 is binary? Okay, binary protocols are more efficient to parse, are more compact on the wire, and are much less error prone. Okay, what does it mean? Well, when you have a textual-based protocol, you are adding a lot of complexity when parsing that messages, okay? Because if you define a binary protocol, you are more limited in that sense. The rules are more strict. But when you allow a textual protocol, well, you have to take a lot of things into consideration when parsing that protocol. You have to, well, there is a lot of problems which might arise. But well, at this point we are talking about implementation issues, which are not the most relevant. But well, in HTTP 1.1, there are up to 5 different ways to parse a message. Okay, that adds complexity to the development of web servers and browser. And in HTTP2, there is just one code path. Okay. Well, one of the side effects of that is that HTTP2 is not going to be usable through internet connections, but I don't think that's a bad thing. Okay, HTTP2 is multiplex. This is the way HTTP what.one works, you send a request. Well, this is pipelining. You send several requests and you get the answer. Okay, this is the way HTTP what.one works. But in HTTP 2, we have two kinds of, this is an HTTP 2 connection. The data unit which are exchanged over the HTTP 2 connection are called streams. And those streams are divided into data streams and header streams, okay? Well, they are self-explanatory. The header stream transports headers, and the data streams transport data, okay? And that happens on both directions, okay? So here you can open a single connection and you can exchange a lot of traffic, totally multiplex, okay? You can mix content of of different streams. Well, this is what we see. You don't need to open so many connections, and that's going to be good for applications better behave in terms of resources used. For example, voice over IP or over TC, they won't have to compete against web traffic, which opens a lot of TCP connections. Well, also header compression is very important because it means a lot of overhead traffic and it increases latency. There are many round trips which are due to the headers. So in this case, that's an important improvement. And well, this is server push. Okay, this is like HTTP 1.1 works, the second diagram flow diagram. Sorry. In this case, you have to ask for different resources, and you get this is the client on the left side and the server on the right side, and you get the content and you receive it. Okay, and this is how it works in HTTP 2. You get the index file, for example, and then the server sends you all the resources. You don't have to ask for all of them individually. Okay, this is the way it works. You ask for a resource to the server, and then the server propose you to download other additional resources which are needed for the web application. Okay, in this case, the web browser needs to be more intelligent. Okay, you have to add more logic. The server needs to understand what is sending to the client. Okay, what are the relationship between the elements which is sending to the client. Okay, this is how HTTP 1.1 messages are transformed into HTTP 2 frames. Okay, here you have a post this is the body content. This is a JSON, a very simple JSON. So this will go in a header frame and this will go in a data frame. Okay, and this is, and those frames are sent over the HTTP 2 connections. Okay, we are not going to see it, but the different frames can have a different priority. So you can send some frames first and you can send some frames later. The priority mechanism is pretty complex, and what's the rationale behind that? Okay, there are some resources, for example, the index HTML file it has more priority than, for example, an icon image or any image. Okay, so you can do that with HTTP 2. Okay, this is the protocol stack. Okay, this is what this was the a transient period where you have a SPDY. You are using HTTP. Actually, this is not totally true because SPDY and HTTP. You don't have a different layer here, but in terms of from the web browser point of view and the web server point of view, it works this way. And then you have TLS here. But we are moving to this other stack. Okay, you still have IP here, which is going to be IPv6 in some years, or it already is IPv6 in some applications. Or if you establish an IPv6 connection, again, your internet provider or a specific site. Then you have QUIC here. We are going to see QUIC very briefly. And then you have HTTP2, okay? And here you have the web application, okay? For example, WebRTC would be here, okay? It's not related to HTTP2, okay? They are independent. We'll see it later. Okay, this is, okay, because you can say, okay, what are the advantages of HTTP2? There are several studies, but I found this one, and those are tests, and the performance of HTTP2 over TCP is better in challenging environments. When you have a lot of bandwidth, and when the round trip is very low, HTTP2 even works worse than HTTP 1.1, okay? But we are using here TCP. When you are using, instead of TCP, you are using QUIC, the performance is even better, okay? But what those graphics say? When you have a low bandwidth, the performance of HTTP2 is better than HTTP 1.1, and when the round trip is gets higher, the performance is also better. So as you can see, you can get a 20% reduction on the time of load compared to HTTP 1.1. Actually, SPDY, and now HTTP2, is already used by many Google apps in mobile. Okay, they use SPDY between your mobile phone and a data compression proxies, and then they send HTTP traffic to the different sites. Okay, so this is something which has been used for several years. So this is not something new. Okay, the idea is that all the applications move to start to use HTTP2 here, because especially for mobile connections, the performance is going to be better. Well, there are mechanisms because your web applications can be served using HTTP 1.1 and HTTP2 simultaneously. I mean, the transitions has not to be traumatic, okay? Using the same software, you should be able to use both protocols. There is a mechanism called upgrade, which also is also used to create WebSocket connections. In this case, we are saying, okay, I need to load to get the page resource, but I want to upgrade the connections to HTTP2. Okay, and then the server can answer 200 okay, and you receive the page. In this case, you are still using HTTP 1.1, or you can receive 101 answer, and you upgrade the connection to HTTP2. Okay, but this mechanism is not going to be used in practice because this only works for unencrypted connections, because when you are encrypting the connection, when you first establish the HTTP connection, you don't know, you cannot negotiate the protocol you are going to use at application level. Okay, so that's the reason why there is an extension of TLS called ELPN, where when you create the TLS connection, you are negotiating the application protocol that you are going to use. Okay, and this is what is going, which is being used in practice. I think if you get with Wireshark the traffic of your web browser with Twitter, you are going to see things like that in the handshake phase of the TLS connection. Okay. Well, are there HTTP2 available implementations? Yes, there are many of them. It's actually supported by Firefox, Chrome, also Wireshark, but it's, as far as I know, it's still not implemented by the main web servers. I don't know if you already can use HTTP2 with Apache or Nginx, but it's just a matter of time, and I'm sure there are implementations also with Node.js to use HTTP2. So you can already try it and you can already experiment with it, and I say it's in use. Okay, well, maybe you know something about WebSocket, or you know everything about WebSocket. Are competing protocols? No. Okay, the short answer and the definitive answer is no, because you can do what WebSocket allows is to create a bidirectional connection between client and the server. Okay, if you open a WebSocket connection, you can send any content. You as a client can send any content to the server, and the server at any time in an asynchronous way can send you any content to the client. Okay, so that's something we saw that HTTP is a client server protocol. You send a request and you receive an answer. So WebSocket allows to avoid that limitation. Okay, and that's something, HTTP2 is also a client-server protocol, so both of them are complementary. You can use HTTP2 and also WebSocket. Actually, there is an ongoing RFC draft to be able to use WebSocket over HTTP2. Okay, this is the RFC. This is not the last version because this is expired. But I think it's still not a definitive RFC, but I'm pretty sure that it's going to be, okay? Well, in the meantime, between while we are still adapting our web servers, we can use a protocol gateway. So, as we saw, the most important advantages of HTTP2 happens between the client and the server, okay, on the access side. What happens here is not so relevant because this happens in fiber connections with a lot of bandwidth and very low latency. But what happens here is relevant because it can happen over Wi-Fi connection or 3G and 4G, so this can be one of the approaches we might find in the next year to be able to use HTTP2 on the client side, but without changing our servers. Okay, there are many vendors which are working on this kind of devices. Well. what's the relationship between the WebRTC and HTTP2? Okay, they are independent. Okay, there is an independence between both of them because WebRTC uses a different protocol stack. What's the common point? Both of them are going to be used from web application. Okay, when you want to in the next years, when you want to create a web application which is going to be executed by a browser on the wire, you are going to get HTTP2 and you are going to get WebRTC traffic, and that will allow to create applications with a great user experience. Okay, you are going to web applications are going to perform even better than native application, and without a huge engineering overhead. Okay, if you want to develop an application which is which performs very well, you have to invest a lot of time and money in getting things perfect. In this case, you are going to take advantage of HTTP2 and WebRTC implemented in the browsers to create that kind of applications. Okay. Well, and now just a few slides about QUIC. As I said, QUIC is a new transport protocol. HTTP2 is a session protocol which replaces HTTP 1.1. What are the design goals of QUIC? Well, the first and most important one is that it has to be deployed over today's internet. QUIC uses UDP, so to send QUIC messages, you are using a UDP protocol. It has to offer a very low latency to the upper layers in the protocol stack. It has to be reliable because it's going to be used for HTTP and you need to receive all the bytes that the server sent to you. You need to avoid congestion issues, which are very common in TCP. So if one packet gets lost, it shouldn't be a big problem because that's something which is very likely to happen in mobile connections. Privacy and security have to be native to the protocol and comparable to existing solutions, namely TLS. And it has to be adapted to mobile environments. So for example, when you are in a mobile environment, the IP of your device can change. So the transport connections shouldn't be affected by that, okay? Well, why using UDP? UDP is already used for gamers and for voice over IP, and is very latency sensitive. It's a very simple protocol, but it works very well. Google says that almost all the user can have UDP connectivity between their devices and the Google servers. And well, it's already used for many applications, one of them for WebRTC. So, there might be some environments where very restrictive firewalls and also web proxies, which can break the UDP connectivity, but that's something very unlikely to happen in the future. I didn't mention that, but related to web proxies, a web proxy has to analyze the traffic you are exchanging that the users are getting from web servers. With HTTP2, when all the connections are encrypted, the role of the web proxy is not so clear. Okay, that's something that has to be considered. Well, the most important goal of QUIC is to reduce the establishment latency, and it uses very several techniques to achieve that. Okay, but in the best case, you can get a very, very low latency, okay, with encryption compared to TCP and TCP plus TLS. It also uses a multi-stream approach, which is like HTTP2 but a lower level. This is auto-similarity in protocols. And what's the goal of this? If you get a packet loss, it doesn't going to affect the other streams. So the global performance is better. You avoid head of line blocking issues like in TCP. Another key point of QUIC, another relevant point, is that to define a connection in TCP, you use the source and destination IPs and also the source and destination port. Okay, that changes in QUIC. In QUIC, you have an ID for each connection. So if the client source IP changes and that happens in mobile connections, you can still send traffic to the server. Okay, you don't have to reestablish a connection, and that's a very disruptive concept in QUIC. Well, and those are some facts about QUIC compared to existing protocols. So the performance seems to be much better, especially for applications with streaming applications like you do. Well, and that's all. So yes, 5 takeaways before closing the webinar. Well, the first one is that HTTP 1.1 and TCP were not designed for today's internet. They were designed almost 20 and 30 years ago, respectively. HTTP2 optimizes the web applications, especially for mobile connections. So the user experience is much better. The third one is that the performance is even better when used over QUIC, but they can also be used over TCP TLS. And its performance is better for bad connection compared to HTTP 1.1. HTTP 2 and QUIC are already used, and they are used by many important companies. And that's not the case of IPv6, where the adoption is much slower. And the last point is that servers need to be much smarter, but they will use less resources. Okay, the server has to be able to do things like push the content to the client in a proactive way, but you are going to need less servers because you are not going to receive, you won't need to open many TCP sockets between the browsers and your web servers. So that's all. I don't know if
I think that we have here a couple of questions. I have tried to answer some of them, and remember that the slides and probably the recordings will be available. But just sort of two questions. The first one is, what impact would have HTTP2 in the current web server infrastructure?
Okay, so well, yes, all the internet players will have to adapt or change the web servers to be able to use HTTP2. The most important one are already using them. In some cases, the content delivery providers will offer proxies so that you can have an HTTP2 connection between your client devices and the proxy, but you can still use HTTP1. Okay, but well, it will have an impact, you know, on the web server infrastructure.
Okay, and the last one is if you can give us some examples of websites which are already using HTTP2.
Well, I think almost all the Google applications use HTTP2. For example, Google Drive, and also QUIC. And I think Twitter is also using HTTP2. But that's something that you can check with your Wireshark. Is something pretty to see. But I think the main internet companies are moving to HTTP2.
Okay, well, I think that's all in terms of questions. So thanks a lot for sharing your views and your knowledge on this. And that's all. As I mentioned before, remember that the recordings and slides will be available. Thanks a lot for your time.